I call this painting Enlightenment. Much of this show concerns the quest for enlightenment. And this painting symbolizes the eventual goal. If we pan somewhat to the right, we can see the painting that is actually the last painting in the show, which I call Images of the Way. The way being the way to enlightenment. I made this drawing in 1949, when I was 16. The little man crossing the bridge is followed by the small dog. And the path he is following goes up here. And where does it go then? Does it stop at the edge of this cliff? I'm reminded of the fool on the tarot card, who is followed by a little dog and is shown stepping off a cliff. Anybody who embarks on a spiritual quest assumes the role of fool. And 7 years after I made this drawing, I myself embarked on a spiritual quest. When I was 16, I hadn't got to the edge of the precipice yet. I still had ways to go, but I had already had the little dog behind me. So I really think of that drawing as being rather prophetic, autobiographical way. I painted this picture in Spain in 1962. It is one of a whole series of pictures I did at that time where I was trying to paint a vision I had in the Albert Hall in London during a concert in 1960. The basic elements of the vision are all here. I saw the figure on the right first. In point of fact, it was a very female figure and she was looking right at me. So what I have here is not terribly accurate. On the left, I saw this huddled group of men and women all gazing up into the sky. And in the middle, this kneeling woman also looking up into the sky. And for some reason at the time, I thought I was seeing the ascension of Christ and thought, golly, if I wait long enough, I'll see this in the figure of Christ. But no. Instead, from the top right, in came this incandescent ball, which was very large and very solid looking. And it trailed a luminous tail. I'm afraid in this painting, it's rather a muddy tail, but in fact, it was a really luminous tail. This painting, or the vision itself, really, provided me with imagery which I've used really ever since. And we'll find evidence of that later in the show. The two bottom drawings were two of a set of 12 that I did for Robert O. Anderson. It was the first commission I got in America. And the two up above, I did 2 years later, again, a part of another set of 12 that I also did for Robert Anderson. Robert Anderson was my chief patron for many years. I got many commissions from him. This is the first landscape painting that I made in America. That's Carol, the baby son David, standing by the red pickup on the right. I painted this in 1967. It's a view of our valley, just a little west of where we live. And looking up in the distance in the center, we can see Sierra Blanca. My father-in-law's ranch, where my wife and I still live, is called Sentinel Ranch. And it's called Sentinel Ranch because in the old days, they always kept somebody up on a high hill that overlooks the ranch to keep an eye open, to watch out for marauding bands of Apache Indians and also Texans. The population was all Mexican in those days. And here we have the Sentinel on Sentinel Hill. And in the next painting, we can see Sentinel Hill. In the painting, we can see Peter Hurd's home. And you move over here, and this is where we live. That white building being my studio. In the far distance, we see the Captain Mountain Range. Painted this in 1968. It's looking down on Peter Hurd's ranch with Hibbs home on the left and ours two-thirds of the way across painting to the right. In the middle of the painting we see a herd of horses and Carol and her, the lovely Arabian we used to have in those days. Seems to be leading horses away from the coming storm. These three drawings are all done with India ink on gesso. In 1974, I was commissioned to paint a mural for the Texas Tech Museum in Lubbock. The subject of the mural was to be water, and I eventually used a small crib dam just down the valley from where we live. As the central motif of the mural, which was really a detailed study of rocks, timbers, and running water. And it was done in exactly the same, with the same technique as these three drawings. You'll no doubt not be surprised to be told that it took me 6 months. The mural was 40 feet long by 17 feet high. In contrast to these highly detailed drawings, I went through a phase of really loosening up and producing a body of work which I think owes quite a lot to Chinese painting. These three examples will serve to show you what I'm talking about. These are 12 drawings, paintings, all done in 1974, and they were part of a set of 40 paintings. which were incredibly all bought by one person. He bought the entire exhibition, and eventually he gave them to Eastern New Mexico University in Roswell, where they hang in the library. In 1972, I found myself very stuck in my work, lacking inspiration. And so I did what I'd done in the past, which may sound really stupid, but I found it really works, which is to put what one happens to be painting on the floor, and then simply start chucking paint. On this particular occasion, I had 12 small panels already primed, and I put them all on the floor and threw paint at them. I was using water-based paint, so what I'd done was dry when I came back to the studio in the morning. And I set them up at the end of the studio and started looking at them rather as one would look in a crystal ball. And to my absolute astonishment, I found in each one of these little panels the image of a bearded old man. Since he was always in an otherwise empty landscape, I decided to call him the Hermit. And the Hermit became a regular feature of a lot of later paintings, and I have three of them here. In this one, he's standing there with his cat and his bird. And in this one, he's painting a bird. And one above, he's hiding behind a tree, watching a flying saucer take off. 1980. This was a hot year for me. I had numerous albums of photographs of most of my work. And it suddenly occurred to me that I really ought to start using these albums of photographs as though they're books of preliminary sketches, because I felt that I could develop a lot of these paintings much further into something more powerful. This one, I think, worked out particularly well. I've always liked it. Why they have enormous feet and tiny heads, I'm not quite sure, but they seem to look just about right. I had a show of all these big canvases, some bigger than this, and I had a show of them at the old armory building in Santa Fe. And for one reason or another, all the invitations to the opening didn't arrive until the show came down. It was only up for 6 days because I was being given the space free. And I was really absolutely, I thought this was my best work ever, and hardly anybody came to the opening. However, the second day, I got a call from a friend of mine who was a Buddhist. He said, there's an important Buddhist here in town. He's the head of their whole spiritual side as opposed to political side, and speaks no English but has an interpreter, and I want to bring him to your show. And this friend brought Kenpo Katha Rinpoche to my show, and he was a goat herder's son. Sweet man, sweet, lovely presence, and a young man who interpreted it brilliantly. And Kenpo Katha Rinpoche, he went all the way around the show and looked at everything. And then he turned to the interpreter and said, these paintings should speak to all people, regardless of their race or their creed, or words to that effect. And I was absolutely overwhelmed, because this had always been my ambition, to try and produce imagery which did cut through all religious, racial barriers, etc. And to hear this out of the mouth of this really extraordinarily beautiful human being, I remember I went off with this friend of mine, and
to a Mexican restaurant. And I remember weeping into my enchiladas out of sheer happiness. I've painted this image many times. In many respects, it's the culmination of the quest. It brings together two images, uniting them, one male and one female. And the male is based on a Tibetan Buddhist image they call the Three Lords of Materialism, who are mind, speech, and form. A female trio stem from ancient Greece and are the original three muses of Greek myth, who are meditation, memory, and music. For starters, the union of mind and meditation, the outcome is pretty obvious. It's the first step towards enlightenment when people start meditating. The golden ball at the top of the painting is the same golden ball that I tried to paint back in 1962 in Spain, and which you saw earlier. From the ball, get the channel of awareness coming down and enveloping this group, which is trying to suggest that consciousness, individual consciousness, has now become a channel for the light of God to shine in the world. So the three lords and the three muses are aspects of ourselves, and in fact all the quest imagery relate to individual you and me. The dove, as you see, has come to the figure on the right, and he's the figure of form. And what I'm trying to suggest is that what we call reality, our reality, is now imbued with the spirit of truth. In other words, thy kingdom has come on earth as it is in heaven. And that's as far as I know how to tell the story. This is yet another picture of the channel of awareness. The man and woman are enthroned. They have entered the kingdom of heaven. And she holds the fruit of enlightenment, whereas he holds the truth that makes you free, which is the fruit of enlightenment. In trying to tell the story of the quest, in the beginning, it always took about 40 pictures to tell the story. This was terribly cumbersome, and I wondered if, by amalgamating imagery, I couldn't reduce the number. And in 1987, I did in fact reduce the number to 12. In this particular series we're looking at now, as you can see, there are 8. I've no intention of speaking about each of these pictures in turn. It would take all night. Much of what I've already said about other paintings will explain what's going on in these pictures. I've explained who the three men are and the three women who appear in the middle of each painting. Each painting, apart from the images of the lords and muses in the middle, and the story of how the three lords evolve thanks to the coming of the three muses one by one, the secondary story, the more outer story of the man and the woman, and there are two images of the man and the woman going through their various adventures in each of the pictures. As for the man, the woman, the horse, and the dove, the man symbolizes intellect, the woman intuition, the horse instinct, and the dove insight. They all begin with I, which is meaningful insofar as they all are you, I painted this picture in 2001. I call it Divers. They're diving into this pool and reaching out for this bird, who rather mysteriously seems to be flying underwater. The pools are archetypal symbols of the unconscious, and men and women are simply diving in their own unconscious in quest of the truth, symbolized by the dove.
This is simply a picture of three happy women dancing on a beach. It could be seen as the three muses in their sort of maiden aspect. But as far as I'm concerned, they're just three happy young ladies.
I've painted many, many female heads, but this head has always meant more to me than any of the others I've ever painted. It represents my own muse in a way I really can't even begin to explain.
Having reduced the number of images trying to tell the story of the quest to 8 paintings, which we're looking at a moment ago, I began to think how I could reduce the number even more. And as luck would have it, right at this time I was given a beautiful book full of reproductions of Tibetan Buddhist tankas, which are these elaborate paintings, usually with the Buddha in the middle, and all manner of things going on around him.
And I designed this very much on those lines, with all these individual little paintings, and telling the story really on two levels. The slightly more outer, exoteric level being along the top and along the bottom, and the real nitty-gritty of what's going on in consciousness in the paintings to the left and right of the center image, which you might say is the culminating image of the whole thing, where consciousness has become a channel for the light of God.